What's up, guys? This video was originally going to be part of the next Neutrino Launcher update video that I'm currently working on, but this section went on for way too long, so I decided to just make it its own thing. Let's talk about the Memcard Pro 2. For the uninitiated, this is one of several smart memory cards that has become available for the PlayStation 2 in the past couple years. The idea behind these things is that you put an SD card in them, and then that gets used to store save games, giving you functionally unlimited memory card space. Now, I'm making this review because my opinion of the Memcard Pro 2 is decidedly less positive than all the other coverage I've seen of it. For context, the Memcard Pro 2 is currently the single most expensive PlayStation 2 smart memory card you can get. This thing cost me over $50, not including shipping, which is nearly twice the price of the next most expensive smart memory card I could find. That price disparity is where most of my issues with the Memcard Pro 2 stem from. I want to be clear that if this thing were like 25, 30 bucks, I would not have most of the complaints that I do. Let's start with the build quality. It's not bad by any means, but it feels notably less premium than the price point and packaging would suggest. The plastic and overall construction feel nearly identical to the MX4 SIO card I got for $12 on AliExpress. It's certainly adequate, I don't feel like the card is going to fall apart in my hand or anything, but it does feel a bit less solid than an OEM PS2 memory card, which is disappointing. The buttons also feel kinda cheap. If you look closely, you can see that pressing them flexes the PCB a little inside the housing. My particular unit also has a defect, where the integrated display is slightly crooked. It's not enough to cut off any of the readable area, but it is very noticeable. Also, why in the current year argument does this thing have a micro USB port? This connector is awful. I thought we all agreed on that. There is no reason to still be using it on a new device when USB-C has been around for nearly a decade at this point. The one thing I will say for the build quality is that the Memcard Pro 2 has the clickiest, most satisfying microSD slot of anything I own. I've had it sitting on my desk for the past couple weeks, and it makes a really good fidget toy. All of that hardware stuff is pretty minor though, because most of the value of something like a smart memory card lies in the integrated software. The Memcard Pro 2 fares much better in that regard. After copying some files to the SD card and a quick firmware update, pretty much everything just works straight away. The two main features this thing has are title ID detection, where the card will automatically detect what game you're playing and mount a dedicated virtual memory card for that game, and MMCE loading, which allows game ISOs to be run from the Memcard Pro 2 with a backup loader. Both of those features work great, and I don't really have much to say beyond that. What I want to talk about are the network features, because that's the one part of the software that let me down. The trouble started with just trying to get this thing to connect to my Wi-Fi network. I live in a busy area, so I have a MAC address filter on my network for added security. Usually this isn't a problem, it just takes a couple extra steps to connect a new device to the network, and then it's all good. It was a problem for the Memcard Pro 2 though, because the MAC address for the built-in Wi-Fi card isn't viewable anywhere prior to connecting to a network. It's not listed in the settings on the card, or in the network setup interface, and it's not printed anywhere on the card itself. They were able to fit the entire FCC compliance statement onto this tiny sticker, but couldn't make room for a mere 6 bytes of hexadecimal. I even opened this thing up to check the Wi-Fi adapter itself, because the MAC address is often printed directly on those, yet it was nowhere to be found. I cannot overstate how abnormal this is. I've had a MAC filter on my Wi-Fi for about 10 years now, and even the absolute cheapest, most garbo Wi-Fi devices I've used in that time have always had their MAC address listed somewhere. I have literally never encountered this problem before. This wouldn't even be that big a deal, because the card hosts its own internal web server and broadcasts a short-range Wi-Fi network, which is how you connect it to another network in the first place. The problem is that that's the only thing you can do when directly connected like this. You can't get to any of the other settings that are normally accessible through the web interface. If you try to go to the settings page directly, it'll just forcibly redirect you back to the network setup. This is so needlessly limiting, and I'm sure mine isn't the only edge case. What if someone set this up in a corner of their house that doesn't have good signal? Or what if you brought your PS2 over to a friend's and want to check something in the web interface? Or what if the card just plain won't connect to your Wi-Fi network for some reason? I know that last one is a distinct possibility, because that's exactly what happened to me after I disabled MAC address filtering on my network. I spent the better part of an hour troubleshooting, rebooting my router, trying different channel settings, etc., but no matter what I did, I could not get the Memcard Pro 2 to connect, and I could not tell you why. As a reminder, this is a $50 device. the most expensive of its kind by a fair margin. That price disparity is made all the worse with some additional context that I left out earlier. Despite all my negativity, you would still expect there to be some redeeming quality, some sort of killer feature, or something that sets the Memcard Pro 2 apart in order to justify its price. Well, it does have one, but I really don't think it's worth it. Let me explain. Remember when I said that the Memcard Pro 2 cost almost twice as much as the next most expensive device in its category? Well, that device is the Memcard Pro, also produced by 8-Bit Mods. Comparing the feature sets of these two cards on the manufacturer's website reveals that they are nearly identical. Originally, the Memcard Pro was designed more for the PS1 and did have a feature set that was more distinct from the Pro 2. However, there's since been multiple firmware updates for both devices, and now all the features that are actually going to matter to most people are pretty much the same across both of them. In terms of hardware, the only meaningful differences between the two are that the Pro 2 has a higher resolution display and a micro USB port. That USB port forms the backbone of the Pro 2's big killer feature, that being that you can connect a mass storage device over USB and use that in place of an SD card. That could actually be a pretty big value add for some people. The only problem is that makes the choice to go with micro USB over USB Type-C orders of magnitude worse. I'd be willing to bet that the majority of people watching this have a USB Type-C to Type-C cable somewhere in their home. I'd also bet that a pretty good chunk of you have external hard drives or USB sticks that use Type-C connectors. Now, how many of you have a micro USB host adapter cable? Probably not nearly as many, and those who do probably haven't used it since they last had a phone with micro USB 5+ years ago. Do you see the problem here? With the Pro 2, you're paying at least $20 extra to get a feature that's inconvenient for most users and isn't future-proof. That isn't the only advantage that the Memcard Pro 2 has, but everything else consists of minor features that the regular Memcard Pro would likely be capable of if they weren't arbitrarily restricted in software. For example, both cards can upload save games to a remote server, but only the Pro 2 can do it automatically. That leads nicely into my single biggest gripe with these devices. The firmware for them is closed source. All those network connection issues I mentioned earlier, I likely could have fixed, or at least worked around, if I had had access to the source code. That's the real reason not to get a Memcard Pro 2, or Memcard Pro for that matter. They are expensive and proprietary, and they're going up against the SD to PSX. For those who don't know, the SD to PSX is essentially just an open source Memcard Pro 2. It has most of the same features, plus a USB interface that isn't obsolete. You can make your own SD to PSX if you've got the skills, but people also sell them on marketplaces like eBay and Etsy. There's also the Memcard Gen 2, which is just a mass-produced version of the SD to PSX. You can snag one of those for about 20 bucks on AliExpress. The one big drawback is a lack of Wi-Fi, so the Memcard Pros are your only option if you really want those networking features that I couldn't get working. Now, the reason I have a Memcard Pro 2 instead of an SD to PSX is because, one, you guys have been asking for months for me to add Memcard Pro 2 support to the XEB Plus Neutrino launcher, but also, I didn't fully realize what the SD to PSX was at the time I made my purchase. It wasn't until I had the Memcard Pro 2 and began researching the MMCE protocol that I learned what the SD to PSX actually was and knew I had made a mistake. The whole reason I could afford to make that mistake, though, is thanks to the generosity of my YouTube channel members. You can join them at the link down below if you would like to contribute to the suboptimal financial decisions that make my development projects and these videos possible. Also, subscribe to the channel if you want to see my next video, where I'll show you guys what I've actually been doing with my Memcard Pro 2. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys later.